Okay, so we've reached the realization, recognition, let's call it recognition. Realization might be a little way to say ultimately is what we want is abidance. So we can say we've reached the recognition that there's nothing to be liberated from. And this recognition is essentially the precursor to abidance. Simple abidance. There's nothing to be liberated from. Very high recognition, very close to abidance. There's no question about it. Very close to abidance. So, we're not going to jump the gun on anything. Hopefully, I feel like I need to get going here on this. But full stop on the way. I woke up this morning and it came back to me last night. This recognition, and I still had it. So I said, "Wow, wow, this is tremendous. I haven't lost it." There's nothing to be liberated from. This is the key insight. Okay, this is the ultimate insight, but it's not still not abidance, but it's very close to it. The ultimate insight is there's nothing to be liberated from at all. There is no body, there is no world. You could say the only thing to be liberated from is the belief that there is something to be liberated from, if you want to put it that way. Or there's neither something to be liberated from, nor is there not something to be liberated from, if you want to use the neither nor. But ultimately, the abidance is awareness that there isn't anything to be liberated from. So you could say conversely, the key delusion that binds us is the belief there is something to be liberated from, which is the belief that we have changed what God is, changed reality, therefore reality doesn't exist anymore. But therefore we don't have to go back home. There's no home to go back to, so we can stay just exactly as we are in our beliefs, stay with our beliefs, and we'll be happy because the continuity fear will dissipate. This is a false path. Doesn't work. So there's just that is the key delusion that there's something to be liberated from. Some situation, some circumstance, something. Abidance is not abiding in liberation. Now I'm going off of the experiences I've had with that, and it's not abiding in liberation. Freedom is not freedom from something at all. It's just pure freedom. If it was freedom from something, it wouldn't be pure freedom. Because how did that other something happen? It'd be a lack of freedom, which would change reality. So so abidance is just abidance in what is. In the inherency of freedom, of our true nature, of reality, just abidance, in no effort, as far as liberation is concerned. Now, of course, it will seem pragmatically we'll make efforts to talk, to move about, to do things, but we're talking about no effort to be liberated from anything. Not because we're already liberated, but because there's nothing to be liberated from. So this is the key area that non-duality is aiming to get us to, as far as insight goes. And then one more step is abidance. People drove by, they're cursing. Personality's cursing. Personality is just the voice of continuity fear, encouraging the false path. That's all it is. It's an encouragement to believe that there is something to be liberated from, which is directly saying that we have changed reality. That's directly saying so. It's not even a circuitous way. It's actually very direct. Now, sure, we have problems with our what we see as circumstances. I'm in a miserable place. Silicon Valley is gone. What do you call it? It's gone postal. You know, I mean, it's out of control. So miserable situation in every which way you look at my situation, or you call it, is miserable, in every way. And we can complain about that, which doesn't seem to do any good. It never has. Or we can keep going for this insight and see how the chips fall, you know, with this. And so I guess this is the way to go. Just keep working on this, you know, and get to abide and see what happens. I don't know what will happen. But I don't see any other, you know, for me, I don't see any other possibility. So just go keep working on it. See what happens. Nothing to be liberated from. There's absolutely no liberation at all. I'm not abiding in liberation. So I feel if we keep emphasizing this and get familiar with it, we'll be able to be in abidance. This is the core issue. If we haven't resolved this decisively, and remember, what is decisive? Familiarity is decisive. Familiarity is decisive. So when we get familiar with this, this will end up being decisive for us, and we will be in abidance. This is how I see it. So we just have to be patient and keep getting familiar with it. This is just the path of wisdom, discipline, mental discipline. There is nothing to be liberated from. I'm not liberated. Not at all. To say a liberated sage is delusional. There's nothing to be liberated from. There's a sage in abidance, in non-dual abidance. And nothing to be liberated from abidance. So you might say, there's a nothing to be liberated from abidance sage. Of course, the personality will completely misinterpret this. Oh, that means the body is real, the world's real. Okay, well, oh great, we'll follow that then. Of course, that's not what's being said. It's saying that it's not real at all. The body and the world is not real at all. They don't exist. They never have never existed. So I've never been a body. I've always been free. I always have remained a spirit exactly as God created me. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I've always remained spirit, exactly as God created me. Okay? Say this. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I've always remained spirit, exactly as God created me. Say that. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I have always remained spirit, exactly as God created me. Therefore, what is there to be liberated from? Except just an idle whim, you know, which has never been anything. So, there's no. Now, this is the thing. Shift into abidance, there's no sense of liberation happening or anything happening. It's just, oh, yeah, this is it. Oh, wow, this is great. And then after a while, it starts working on your mind like, well, what did I triumph over? You know, what did I get liberated from? I don't see it. I'm not quite aware. I forgot. And then you start thinking, and then the abidance disappears. Okay, so this is the trickiness of the whole situation. Because we didn't get liberated from anything. So as long as we have the belief, the false personality continuity fear belief that salvation comes from liberation from something, we will not have abidance. And so we'll have a false spirituality. This is what the personality teaches. This is what the continuity fear teaches. This is what the world is following. They're caught in this trap, dualistic trap. And they decorate it. Decorate it, decorate it, decorate it, decorate it, decorate it, decorate it. Put lipstick on the pig. It's the same old pig. And as long as we keep following this false path, false spirituality, false path, we will get a return ticket. Return ticket, return ticket. As long as we keep listening to continuity fear, we'll keep getting a return ticket. That's it. And only when we listen to the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, as it gets to us, and we are able to pay attention to it in many different ways. It can be in many different ways. It's unique to each one in certain ways. But when we do that, then we come up, we finally are led to the truth. The continuity fear, which is expressing itself as the personality complex, will never ever bring us to the truth. It will always still be steeped in duality of the idea of being liberated from something, which is actually a direct declaration and belief that we've changed reality, which is what continuity fear is trying to teach us, so that it says that it will disappear when we finally make this change real, that they're convinced this, and it tells us that it's already real, but just we need to be convinced in this, that, you know, and so we just spend lives trying to convince ourselves that what has never can never happen has happened. Not a very happy experiencing, is it? But we will, as long as we keep going that way, we will always get a return ticket to, you know, identifying with this dream of time, space, process, and form. And always hoping for a magical solution. We just keep convincing ourselves it really has happened. It really has happened. There is no more home to go home to, no reality to go home to. Therefore there's nothing to have continuity fear about. We're already here with the body and the world, and we're used to that, so there's no continuity fear to deal with, no continuity fear. This is magical, 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 magical belief. But if we're just focused on the lipstick on the pig, you know, we can blind ourselves to the fact that it's just a pig, you know. So if we're just narrowly focused on that lipstick, then we lose sight of the pig. And this is what is happening in this world right now, is a very narrow focus is happening. The focus is narrowing down so badly. Only look at the lipstick, only look at the lipstick, only look at the lipstick, you know, that we don't realize what's going on. And return ticket, return ticket, return ticket, you know, buying return tickets, buying a destiny of many return tickets. Who wants to buy that? So, in order for there to be a really effective teacher, there has to be abidance. There's no way around that. And so, this is what we're aiming for. That would be helpful. The more teachers, the better. The more helpful it is. So we're just working on our part in this, and let others work on their part. And, you know, but it's very clear what non-dual, what reality really is, non-dual teaching and abidance is, abidance in no liberation at all. And this is an anathema, of course, to the personality. The personality always will come up and say, well, but we have this great liberation coming up from darkness, you know, being liberated from darkness. Really? Well, how did darkness become real? And if it's not real, you know, what are you doing trying to be liberated from it? Just accept the real as it is right now. If it's not real, how could it be affecting right now what is real? If it's just an idle wish, then If it's something's not real, it's just merely an idle wish. Why do you need to be liberated from an idle wish in terms of defeating some aspect, you know? Just realize that there isn't anything to be liberated from. There's no darkness to be liberated from. Basically, it means there's nothing, there's no change in reality that we need to be liberated from. No change whatsoever. Whether it be light, whether it be more light, you know, we don't need to be liberated from more light, whether it be darkness, whatever. There's nothing that has happened to reality. So there's nothing we need to be liberated from in order to abide in reality. Now, this doesn't mean that your circumstances won't, quote-unquote, circumstances won't change for the better, because you may be in a situation where there's intense pressure to believe the continuity fear's way of salvation, and that's not a good situation. I mean, it's not helpful. I mean, we want abidance, plain and simple. The Holy Spirit wants abidance. I want abidance. Holy Spirit wants abidance. So... being in a situation that is helpful to recognize and then allow abidance, being in a situation that it's helpful to allow abidance, which is no liberation from anything, no liberation. There's nothing to be liberated from. Certainly, pragmatically, it may seem that you seem to be eased into circumstance, eased into that which is helpful. And pragmatically, you can say, well, attitude, beliefs, you know, being around those who have a right oriented towards truth is helpful. Being around those who are not is not helpful. So, of course, there's a level of pragmatism here. That does not contraindicate the ultimate truth at all. Remember, anything that we say we need to be liberated from, whether it be cancer, say it's cancer, this is a statement that we believe reality has been changed. And it hasn't. So that's continuity fear. It's a false strategy to be liberated from anything. Now, that's not to say that we cannot call the projection we call cancer home. Absolutely call it home. Say, look, I don't need this as an excuse to claim that I need liberation. So call all our excuses home. Our projections seem just as excuses. We don't need them anymore. So call them home. So it's not a healing. It's not like you're being liberated from cancer. It's that you're just recognizing that there's nothing to be liberated from, so I don't need to symbolize that in any way. So call the cancer back home and say, just be sit quiet. I don't need to symbolize what doesn't exist in that way or in any way. We're just symbolizing what can never exist and playing with the symbols. So calling those symbols home is not being liberated from something. Okay, it's saying, look, there's nothing to be liberated from, so let's stop this silly game of symbolizing what doesn't exist. And again, you could say, well, we're being liberated from the silly game of believing there's something to be liberated from, if you want to put on the level of concepts. But abidance doesn't need the level of concepts, actually. But in order to talk about it, we can put it that way. And those who are on the path will not get caught in the continuity fear, because personality will say, no, wait a minute. Oh, he says, no, wait a minute. In other words, legalistically. Wait, I see a legalistically. I see an opportunity to apply the strategy of legalism to this. And, say, no, this is grace. We're not. And so the personality, continuity fear fundamentally cannot liberate itself. It's not capable of that. So it will defend its position. But we're here just for the wow. So instead of anyone saying, wait a minute, just go into wow. Oh, I have a question. No. Wow. So a teacher who's abiding knows they're abiding. And so they know the intensity is going out. So they know the wow is arising. So they just can say, just go into the wow. That's what's half glass is half full. Always the spiritual discipline is glass is half full. Always. Otherwise, it's the personality will get a hold of you and problems. So we say, no, it's just wow. I don't have a question. I just have a wow intensity that what I need to do about this. Just abide in it. Full stop in the wow. Abide in the wow for now. Abide in the wow for now. Full stop in the wow. Abide in the wow. Practice that. So you see satsang, the point of satsang is to bring each one of us to this intense wow, and then be quiet, be silent in that, and just abide in that. So it's practicing abidance in an intermediate way, you might say, is the wow reaction, because there's still fear mixed with elation mixed with fear. Practicing that and getting used to abidance, where you say, okay, all I have to do is just sit here quietly. I don't have to be liberated from this, let me just experience it. So, again, abidance is not experiencing the feeling of liberation. It is not there. It's not there. And the personality keeps wanting to experience liberation. I think that's the ultimate, experiencing liberation. So we must make this differentiation very, very important. There's no feeling of liberation in abidance whatsoever. So we're not experiencing liberation. We're experiencing peace. If we think that we need to experience liberation, we won't be in abidance. So again, in abidance, we're abiding, and we start thinking, okay, well, where's the liberation? Okay, now where's that? As soon as we start thinking that, we've lost it. We're out of it. We've shifted out of it. We think, well, I got to explain to people, what was I liberated from? No, you explain to them that I realize there's nothing to be liberated from. And of course, the trouble is that the personality is believing that it's the right path. So it feels that's the right question to ask. Real smart, spiritualized personality says, okay, well, what were you liberated from? I need to know that, and then I can do it too. And you say, well, there's nothing to be liberated from. There's no liberation at all. And they say, well, then you don't have any attainment. What are you talking about? Right, there's no attainment. So this is nonsense. And the personality gets very offended. You say, you're a teacher? This is absolute nonsense. It's crazy. I don't get it. I need to get something. No, there's nothing to get. There's nothing. There's no liberation to get. There's no attainment to get. And again, the personality is quite, you know, undermined, because it completely undermines its entire path. It's a whole belief system, which is all about, see, the personality has developed all this spirituality, fake spirituality, which is all based on liberation, being liberated from something, from attaining something, you know, accomplishing something, triumphing, all this. So it's got this massive, elaborate spirituality that just goes on and on like a vast, endless swamp. And it believes this is the truth. So it says, if you think, well, you're enlightened, okay, well, tell me then, how did you reach enlightenment? What did you overcome? How are you liberated? You know, this, and that. And it thinks that it's in a position to judge, you know, whether you're, you know, in abidance or not. It's in no position to judge whatsoever. But the present time is a time of domination by this personality in this world, severe domination, and they feel that, you know, that they're the ones who are going to determine, you know, who, what is what. Before, everyone had this feeling like, you know, the personality is kind of sinful. It's not really right, you know, and we need something other than that. But with this influx of the modern age, and especially technology, this has greatly encouraged personality worshiping, time worshiping, personality worshiping, believing the personality has the answers. And a tremendous amount of spirituality, personality spirituality, has arisen. And people think that they're on the path and they're making progress and they're you know, getting there, when in fact they're not. Just the opposite. They're just getting a return. They're just getting a lot of return tickets, which is actually what the continuity fear wants. Continuity fear wants us continually bound by this, you know, cycles of existence, so that we can ultimately be certain that we've changed. The reality has been changed. But how can we be certain in what is not true? How can there ever be absolute certainty if we, you know, it's ridiculous. The continuity fear feels very safe when it feels that we have invested in it in the future. So it's trying to sell tickets to the future, future embodiments, you know, future identifications, as many as possible. So if you say, yeah, I'm going to have thousands of more lives, and the continuity fear says, oh, good, 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 that's great. You're really spiritual, that's great. You're doing a great job. Now, we may not directly understand this is what was taking place, but it is. It is. It's investing in delay. So this world is investing in delay very severely. We want to sidestep that. So the Holy Spirit has to find a way for us to sidestep this. And so I just keeps putting the pressure here on me. He says, no, there's no soup for you yet. So I continue with my gruel diet, you know, of this morning was what? Yeah, not so good. Carrot juice, vanilla protein drink, and frozen fruit, mandarin oranges, pineapple, and mango or something. Not very good. Carrot juice doesn't mix so good with the vegetables, I found. Maybe it's better in some other mix. It wasn't quite the right mix. I think cranberry juice is better. If you're going for fruit, go for cranberry juice. Okay, in various blends. They have cran apple, cran this, cran that. Cran coconut, if you can find it, is really good. Coconut syrup, cran coconut. I couldn't find it last time I went shopping. With the fruits, go with the cranberry, you know, and drink carrot juice just straight. Carrot juice just straight is very good. I'm trying to help my eyesight, which is deteriorating, has been. I'm trying to turn that around. Drink it just straight. Drink it straight. It tastes very good. So again, remember in the videos, we alternate between building up the intensity of the wow and then cooling it down, all right? Now this is what we do. Build up the intensity, cool it down. Spiritual intensity, truth intensity. Not just intensity, not personality intensity, not body intensity, personality intensity. Intensity from, you know, glimpsing and recognizing the truth. And it's just like, wow. We're not used to it. We see it's true. They say, but I'm not used to it. Right. So well, that's a problem. Yes. That's why we have to keep going over and over and over this. At some point, we'll say, oh, that's easy. I'm used to it. Why is it easy? Because I'm used to it. Why do we feel at ease with it? Because we're used to it. We're familiar with it. So there's not this wow reaction so much. You know, it's very, very, becomes very, very muted. But we can't try to artificially mute it. Right? We have to let the rawness of the wow rise and keep doing that and keep doing it and keep doing it until it naturally, we do get used to it, and then it's just muted. This is the real path. It's effort. It takes time. It takes time. It takes practice. I mean, patience. You have to keep bringing it up, and gradually get used to it. And then we're at ease with it. So oh, this is easy. I'm at ease. I'm not too elated or frightened. You know, I'm just saying, oh yes, this is fine. No problem. No problem whatsoever. So it's this step by step way, which is, you know, that's the way. The way into accepting no way, of course. No liberation. So we're not going for a feeling of liberation. We're going for the feeling of abidance, which is, you might say, vast, you know, vast quiescence. We can't really describe it in terms of liberated endeavors that we've, all the feelings that have to do with personality and liberation. We cannot really describe it in those terms. It's just like a vast inclusiveness, where you can't lose your position, as it were. You cannot lose your status. You cannot lose your standing. Nothing can lose its standing. Of course, the personality. I say, well, how do I get liberated? I have all these lives. I got to get liberated from this life. No, there is no life to get liberated from. See, you know, can't have your cake and eat it too. Can't say, well, yeah, I'm a person. I have a life. I have to be liberated from the person, from the life. No, we're not a person, and we don't have a life. We've never been a person. We've never had a life. We are life. We have perfect standing in as life. We can't have a life. We cannot have a life, and no one has a life. So we just go over this. So just you keep bringing the wow up and getting used to it. This is what I'm doing for myself. And so now it's, you know, it's feels, I feel somewhat at ease with this. More and more at ease, because years after year after year after year, day after day after day, keep on looking at this. Ron Arshi calls it inquiry. You know, keep looking at this. Keep looking. Keep glimpsing. And he says, look at the eye. I mean, in other words, the person, the notion of a separate will. Look at that. You don't see where it comes from, and ultimately you see it's just a projection. And once you see that, then you call it home, and then it's no longer being projected, so it's no longer an issue. And you see there isn't any I to get liberated from. There isn't any life to get liberated from. And this automatically results in abidance. nothing to be liberated from. The I is just the idea of liberation, actually. That's all that it is. So when we're looking at the liberation, we're doing inquiry. We're just using the term liberation instead of I. I've never been entirely comfortable with the term I, so that's fine. So I would say liberate, the silly idea of liberation is what we're looking at inquiry-wise. And it's the same as Ramana Maharshi saying, look at the I, you know. Where does that come from? Trace it all the way back, and he says you trace it back to, it arises as a thought, a silly notion, an idle whim, idle wish, as Jesus calls it, just an idle wish. So we're doing the same as Ramana Maharshi has indicated. It's very much the same here. There's just subtle terminology difference of saying, you know, the notion of liberation. Where does that come from? Liberation, where does that come from? Look at it. Inquire into liberation. And again, Ramana Maharshi blessed me by in this path by saying it's just as good as what he indicated. He said it'll get to the same recognition and be very, very helpful. He said, don't in the slightest bit feel awkward about it. He said, no, just keep exactly what you're doing and it will work. It will work. And he was right. You know, he's telling the truth, told the truth. And it's quite normal for there to be slight variations in terminologies and emphasis, etc., by different people in different situations, you know, in the world, different. Yeah, that's quite okay in that way. Okay. Ah. We'll have to just do a quick. Just one moment. And so he reassured me. He says, absolutely, that's okay. Absolutely. So this is another big wow. This is another big wow. Maybe I better get this. So, it is a big wow. I mean, we are doing what the greatest sage of the preeminently, one is recognized preeminent sage of non-dual truth, abidant, non-dual abidance, in, say, you know, the last several hundred years or more, you know, right? Is Ramana Maharshi. There's no question about it in terms of general recognition as a non-dual sage in abidance. We are doing exactly what he suggested we do. And having this slightly different style, he's also blessed that. He said, absolutely, do that. This is the way it should be. He said, you don't have to copycat me. You know, he's saying, no, there's no reason to copycat exactly, parrot. I don't want to parrot, you know. No. Use the terminology that you feel is most helpful. If you say this, trace the notion of liberation back to its source, absolutely. It's the same. It's the same notion. You can call the notion different, refer to it in different ways, as long as the focus is there and tracing it back to its root. It's just a mental projection, right? So that's exciting. And Ramana Maharshi has shown up in my dreams recently in a very positive way. So, you know, he's helping us out. He is helping us out here. Oh, speaking of that, I had this very long-haired male sage-like, I didn't know who it was, in a dream last night, and we were walking together, examining this fence and the foundations of this fence. There was this huge fence that was been built, and I was looking at it, and he was just there, and he gave me little post-it notes. He kept giving me little post-it notes. Here, he found something. Oh, I found this, and he gave it to me. I found this, gave it to me. And it was just, like, I imagine it was a man. It was very long hair, in tank top sort of, or some sort of tank top. I don't know who it was exactly, but very quiet, peaceful being that hardly spoke at all and would just point stuff out to me. I saw this fence. And it had been trenched out, and I saw all the way down to the foundation of this fence, and I said, wow, look how this fence is built. My gosh, what a foundation. It's overbuilt to an extreme extent. Look at that. It goes down the ground like 20 feet, and it's embedded in concrete with you know, strong tie hardware, steel hardware, and then pressure treated, very intense, double layers of pressure treated, and this bolted, the whole thing was just like built so intensely. But there was this ditch, a channel had been dug out, I guess, there, to see how it's built. So I was looking at this, so maybe this has to do with looking at this, the defenses, you know, we use the notion of liberation, getting, being able to see the whole structure of defensiveness all the way down to the very foundation of it. Probably that's what it is. So, you know, this is not a joke here. I've dedicated my life to this, and we're getting help from great teachers, and their goal is for us to succeed, plain and simple. They want us to succeed. We want us to succeed. And we will succeed. So it's just a matter of looking at this fence and just be getting used to it, familiar with it, and saying, okay, first it's quite intimidating. So, wow, what a fence that is. Now, if it's all buried, you only see the nice aesthetic part above the ground, right? And you think, oh, that's not a big deal. But we don't realize it's all tied into this heavy, heavy, heavy structure beneath the surface with this heavy concrete foundation. Way down beneath the surface. So we have to excavate like archaeologists to get down there and see it all. And then once we see it, we have to get used to it. And at some point we'll just say, oh yeah, I mean, I see, you know, how it's bolted and all this and whatever. And I see how it's put together. how our defenses, you know, are put together and keep us, you know, hamstrung, really. Get a return ticket. You don't want a return ticket here. This is the problem. That should scare everyone, you know, terribly to get a return ticket here. Now, religions understand this, and from the personality level, they say, hey, they know they have to promise no return ticket. So, you know, Catholicism says, well, take the Eucharist, no return ticket, plain and simple. So, of course, people go there. That's what they're hoping. Now, there's, you know, that's not the answer at all, of course. But it just shows you how powerful this desire is to not get a return ticket. They can just claim some hocus pocus and say, hey, here you go, you know, no return ticket. Oh, gee, that's great. But it doesn't work that way. You have to see and get, you have to recognize there's nothing to be liberated from. There's nothing to go back to, ultimately. The return ticket trip ends when you see there isn't any destination to go back to. It's never been there. As long as you're thinking, yeah, there is a place to go back to, but I've been liberated from that necessity, then you will return to what you believe is there, to a delusion, to a mirage. And you'll feel perishability. You'll feel endangered, another lifetime of endangerment, another experiencing of endangerment. So it's terrible. So abidance comes when we say, well, there is no hell to go back to. There's nothing to go back to. Never has been. So obviously, when that realization comes, how can you go back to something? It's not possible, is it? You see? Yeah, this video is behaving itself. The last one, it kept it. At 24 minutes, it stopped, and then 23, next one, 23:59, next one, 24, next one, 23:59. I had to splice it together. I don't understand why 24? What does that mean? Anyone know? Well, 24th of October was pretty significant, wasn't it? Something trying to interfere, stop us, you know, interesting. I believe, well, anyway, yeah, 24th, interesting, very interesting. So maybe some of the students of Ram Maharshi, students in terms of being inspired by his example, will, you know, emerge, will continue to emerge. Maybe there's already been some, I don't know. I'm not in the position to know that for sure. You know, not being right now in abidance. Maybe this will start to emerge now. He's a very helpful figure because he showcased abidance for us and did it in you know, the 20th century, 19th and 20th century. So we have pictures of him, we have video of him, we realize, yeah, this is absolutely legitimate. So it's very helpful. And Jesus has been supremely helpful in clarifying the whole situation within the context that we needed to have it clarified. The Westerners need this context. The Eastern context, I find, is too difficult. I find it too awkward. There's many assumptions, social assumptions made that culture that are enculturated in shorthand. So they use a lot of shorthand that we simply don't have that acculturation at all, and it becomes very awkward. And Ram Maharshi knows this. That's why he said, do it the way you're doing this. It's right for you. Keep doing it this way. He understands that. There's always an enculturation. And it can be a massive thing as far as shorthand goes and assumptions and what is polite, what is acceptable, what is, you know, just so much. We can't do it in an awkward way. It doesn't work. It doesn't work that way. You have to do it in a way that you feel you're in the flow. So, A Course in Miracles has been supremely helpful in that regard, pragmatically helpful. Ramana highlights what the goal is attainable, and then Jesus gives the pragmatic help in terms of helping us in this enculturation, how to go at it pragmatically. That's a great double team, isn't it? Wonderful. And Longchenpa then shows up and tells me, don't worry about the acculturation of, you know, Tibetan Buddhism, all that. Don't let that stand in your way either. I'm here to support you the way you're doing it. He didn't say, hey, do it my way. You know, he helped out with some practice, but he said, do it the way you're doing it. Keep doing it. Otherwise, it wouldn't have shown up. No teacher has ever told me, you know, oh, stop the way you're doing it. You're doing it. No, he said, keep going. You're doing great. Keep going this way. And again, the recognition is the same. There's nothing to be liberated from. Never has been. I've never been a body, I've always been free. I've always remained spirit exactly as God created me. So there's no destination to get a return ticket back to. As long as we think there's something to be liberated from, we'll think that there's some place that we can have a return ticket back to. And that belief will then return us to that place. Because we cannot abide in reality with this dualistic belief. We don't triumph over death. This is false. Death is just a symbol, again, of the silly notion there's something to be liberated from. Call this silly notion of death back. That's just a projection. Nobody gets liberated from death because death doesn't exist. Just an appearance that we're imagining. It's not easy to full stop and wow. You have to be careful because the mind will wander. For of course it will. So you just bring it back. The mind's used to wandering, very familiar. So let me wander off here. Let me wander off there. It's like a little child that just, you know, 2-year-old that just wanders away, you know. Just, hey, I think I want to go over there. Let me wander over there. And forgets the discipline. The parent has to go, oh, come back, gotta bring you back. You know? 2 seconds later, he's wandering off again. So what's important is not learning, it's familiarity. and not familiar with learning, there's nothing to learn. There's nothing to be liberated from. So how could there be anything to learn? Learning has to do with learning to be liberated. How do we learn to be liberated? There's nothing to be liberated from, so there's no learning required, actually. But there is familiarity required because of continuity fear. We have to get used to this truth that there's nothing to be liberated from. Beautiful day, maybe the last one for a while here. Supposed to rain Sunday, tomorrow, and then supposed to be cool. Major change here. Supposed to cool down, actually. Okay, well, we'll see. We need to cool down right now from the wow of this. This is, you know, super intense. Super intense. Shocking to the whole personality construct, which is just continuity fear. But we're so used to this evaporating that there's not much shock left. You know, it's not too bad. This is the way. If you just keep doing this every day, what's going to prevent you from ultimately, you know, abidance? What can stand in your way? You keep evaporating every day. Ultimately, it's all evaporated. The other way is just to double down on continuity fear, and which is absolutely horrid and wretched. Which is just claiming that reality has been changed, is no more. Therefore, there's no home to go back to. Therefore, nothing needs to be done as far as that concerns, so no continuity fear. And this is, of course, magical. Magical belief, magical thinking. So it's fair to say if we're not working every day on evaporating continuity fear, we're investing in magical belief, magical thinking, wishful thinking. It doesn't work. It's never worked for anyone. It never will. There's no possibility that will ever work. And of course, continuity fear says, well, what do you mean? Prove it. This, blah, 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 blah. You know, well, no teacher's ever said that it'll ever work. And certainly reason will show you clearly it can't possibly work. It's believing that we have the power to change God, which simply isn't true. And all this pretending that we have changed is just our own pretense. It's not that we've changed God, it's that we're pretending that we've changed God. We have the power to pretend. That doesn't mean that it's true. We can pretend to be crippled. That doesn't mean it's true. We could walk with a limp or whatever. We're just pretending, then we just walk normal. It's, oh yeah, I wasn't really hurt at all. You know, it's pretense. Pretense does not prove anything. Doesn't matter how much we believe in it. It still does. It's still pretense. It doesn't prove anything. So we keep waiting for some proof. Then there's no proof at all. Keep trying to orchestrate proof. It's just the same. It's just wishful thinking with no power at all. There's no will in wishful thinking. There's no will in wishful thinking other than the will to keep doing it, you know. But as far as a will of resolution, effectiveness, there's none. Okay, we'll be wrapping this up here fairly soon. I don't want to overburden anyone. It's about an hour now. So success is realizing there's nothing to succeed at. No liberation to succeed at. None whatsoever. People could use sign language when I'm taping. Really. They just don't, you know, don't honor it. They don't understand. The personality doesn't understand. They're, you know, worshiping time instead of honoring it. The personality is always worshiping time, trying to make it real so it can triumph over it. Now, 9 months from now, the way could be very rocky indeed. They're trying to put rocks in everyone's way, rocky path, making it, you know, you can't drive a straight line. You know, if there's boulders everywhere, you got to go around this one, around, and it's like a maze of boulders. You just say, oh, it's too difficult, it's crazy. So, this is the trouble that's coming here, is an attempt to make the path so rocky that it's just prohibitively difficult. One way or another, we won't get trapped in this. One way or another. I can't really say what the Holy Spirit, how it will move us, you know, how what will happen. I cannot say. Just have to keep practicing here, full stop in the wow. I've never been a body, I've always been free. I've always still remained spirit, exactly as God created me. I've never been a body, I've always remained perfectly free. I've always still remained spirit, exactly as God created me. Always. There's never been any change in that whatsoever. An idle wish does not change it. No matter how fervently we cling to such an idle wish, no matter how we try to worship the idle wish, it doesn't change it, change reality at all. It has no effect, no matter how much we worship it. So it's like a summer day today, October October 31st, like a summer day, but this may be the end of it for a while. At least here.
At least here.
Yet, on today, we have come up, seen the full foundation of this defensiveness, which is auspicious, very auspicious, okay? Don't want to overstate it, because the wow will kick up too strong. I just say, okay, yeah, okay, I've seen it. Okay, fine, I'll keep looking at it. Take it in stride. Take note of this, take note of that. So in the dream, this friend was just saying, take note of this, and give me a little sticky note, like say, take note of this. Oh, take note of this, a little thing. I said, I'd read and say, oh, yeah. So it's just like a matter of staying in this calmness, so you can take note of this, take note of that, take note of that. Just take note of it and just say, wow. Let your reaction be, wow, I just noted something. Okay. Hindsight will, as your wow wears off, hindsight will put it in perspective and you'll say, oh, yeah, I get it. So oftentimes we realize I need to take note of this, but we don't know exactly why. Well, just take note of it anyway. And hindsight, once the wow wears off, you'll see it. Will be seen. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I've always remained spirit, exactly as God created me. I've always remained spirit, exactly as God created me. I never became flesh. There's no such thing as flesh. I never became that. Never became anything other than what I am. Never. So, how could I need to be liberated from what I never became in the first place? Right? So there's, see, the two different directions. The personality is all about this spirituality of liberation. We need to be liberated from this. We need to be liberated from that. And it sounds great. It sounds great, doesn't it? We don't understand. There's really a defense against truth. It's actually asserting that we have become something different than what we are. So it's asserting that our will is stronger than God. Direct assertion. I need to be liberated from this. It's a direct assertion that our will is greater than God's. Direct assertion. Personality, all it does is make direct assertions of this, and it tries to hide this, hide it, no, well, this is different. Then it says, well, this is different, no, same direct assertion. Well, this is different, no, same direct assertion. It keeps doing this. That's all it does. It says, well, what form of direct assertion can I use? How can I put it to you so you don't see it as a direct assertion? Well, that would be delusion to not see it as a direct assertion. There is no form that can hide the truth of a direct assertion. I mean, that's magical belief, right? Making a direct assertion, you say, well, but the way I put it means that it's okay. Means it's legitimate. No, there's no way we can put it. There's no way we can put it that asserting that we changed our wills greater than God because we changed what God created. There's no way to put that isn't direct assertion of what is impossible. There's no way to put it. The personality keeps thinking, well, if I just put it in a certain form, that'll be okay. It'll make it true. It'll be okay. No, make it true. There is no way to put it. There is no format of putting that'll make it true. None whatsoever. It's all exactly the same. And it wants us to wade through the swamp of evaluating each one as if they're somehow different. No. Any belief in liberation is a direct assertion that our will is greater than God's. Any belief in learning and teaching, in liberating, which is learning how, being taught how to be liberated, is a direct assertion that our will is greater than God's. Plain and simple. which is not true. So again, all the personality ego does is try to put different shades of lipstick on the pig. So what shade of lipstick can I put it on that you won't recognize that it's really a pig? Yeah, there isn't any. From the standpoint of truth, there isn't any. It's just saying, what form of self-delusion do you want that you will be acceptable to you? There isn't any form of that is acceptable to God, so there's no form that's going to be acceptable to me. It's impossible. There's no form of asserting that our will is greater than God's that could ever be acceptable to God. So it can never be the slightest bit acceptable to me either, or any of us. So there's no wading through all the non-existent differences is a complete waste, you know, complete futile endeavor. We don't have to do it. There aren't any differences. Because each one says, well, this one, you know, is more acceptable to God than the other. No, there's no form of our contention that our will is greater than God's that is can ever be the slightest bit acceptable to God, and therefore can never be the slightest bit acceptable to us, because we're an extension of God. This is what Jesus wants us to get to reckon, so stop wasting time trying to sort through these different shades of lipstick. There's nothing to sort through. It's all exactly the same assertion. So what is there to sort through? It's just one assertion being done in different tones of voice. So what is there to sort through? Tones of voice? No. It's the same assertion. It's the content. There's not the exact same content. It's just the packaging is different. Why do we have to open up all these different packages when we know the content's exactly the same in every single package? This is a waste on our part. It's folly. It's a delaying game. So keep at it here. Hopefully everyone's still watching the videos, because this is, you know, the intensity is definitely here. And we're really, you know, getting to it. Getting to that there's nothing to get to. We're really getting to the real acceptance there's nothing to get to. Really getting to the realization there's nothing to get to. We're really getting to the realization that there's nothing to get to. Really getting to the realization there's nothing to get to. Really getting to the realization there's nothing to get to. And again, don't think about it, don't try to figure it out, don't try to learn it, just feel the wow of this. The wow is inherent in hearing this and accepting it. Okay. Great. And that's it for this one. Full stop in the wow. Just let yourself stay calm, stay focused, stay centered. Just say, hey, this is shocking. That's great. Positive shock. I'm just in this positive shock. Enjoy it. That's it.